Please turn on your camera. Ku, Rahma. I'm waiting. Turn on your camera, please. Okay, a little bit for Rahma to turn on her camera. Sorry. Now, this would be our last lecture before we head it to Easter break, and also the midterm exam. Okay. For midterm exam, like I said, there will be no sit-down exam for you. So instead, I need you later to submit the report. Okay. So I will ask you to submit some the progress report. I will specify what's in the progress report later, but you need to prepare reports, okay? And then you need to submit it through kuliah site, okay? And that progress report will replace the midterm exam. In a sense, what you need to submit is a formal report, and I said formal. You need to have introduction. Okay, so before I continue, please, Francisco, Rodea, Rahma, Tabitha, turn on your camera, please. Okay, thank you. So, I'll repeat what I said. So, for midterm exam, you need to submit the formal progress report. The content of that report would show everything that your group have done up until now. This is actually a compilation of everything that you already submitted, okay? But all with all the revision. And you need to have a formal progress report structure. Like you have a table of content, you have title, you have people who create or responsible for the report, okay, the creator, and also you have executive summary, you'll have introduction, and so on and so forth. And also, not only you report what you have done, you need to put the reasons why you did that. I mean, for examples, if you decided to have 2 weeks of planning, you need to justify why it's 2 weeks and what would you do with those 2 weeks in planning. Okay, so that's the content of the report that you need to submit. submission will be on Kuliah site, and I will set aside time. The deadline would be on the exam date. Okay, so the deadline would be on this exam date and also the time, you know. So for example, if you're I haven't received any exam schedule, but for example, if your exam started at 8 and ended at 10, so the deadline will be at 10. Okay, so that's for the midterm exam. Okay, I will not give you any assignment today, but you need to prepare a report for the midterm. Any question? So it has to be a formal progress report, okay, with all the formality. So no typo, no mistake. You have to edit the report. I will mark down any typo or any mistake that you know, small trivial mistake that you should correct it. I'll mark on your assignment if I found that. Okay, professional formal report should be edited for grammar and typo. Okay, so if before this I give you some slack on your report, it won't happen here because I need formal professional report. Okay, any question about the midterm exam? Anything you want to ask or clarify? Is that clear? Well, okay. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Fine. as usual, you may sorry, you may drop me a question through Microsoft Teams or email if you have any. Okay. So, like I said, just prepare for the exam. Okay. Let's continue our lecture today by looking at the system process requirement. Okay. Oops, sorry. Okay. So analyzing system process requirement. So when you look at any information system, it's not only specifying what kind of information that you require for that system. It's not only specifying what kind of data will get into the system, but also how the process from data being entered into the system, the data being processed inside the system, and how the output generated by the system and delivered to the users. We need to specify the process. Why? Because even though the substance or the essence of information system similar, but each organization have their own way to deliver or to manage the process. Some organization requiring you to have a laborious process, some other organization require you to have only slick and you know a short process. Depends. Let me give you examples. Any of you familiar with the BCA internet banking? No?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you did. Okay, so you do, sorry. So do you have the token from BCA?
Yes.
Okay, so how many times you need to generate code with the transaction?
The code of the token?
Now, you know, when you have transaction over BCA internet banking, you usually ask by the system to enter some code into the token, and then you enter the number from the token to the system, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's at least you need to did that twice, right?
Twice, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Good. That's for BCA. Thank you. So it's, and it seems, you know, too laborious for me, but that's BCA. You know, if I don't like it, I can choose another bank. Yeah. So what BCA did, every time a customer want to conduct transaction, execute transaction, like transferring money, paying something, the customer need to enter security generated by the token twice. I don't know why. Okay. Perhaps it has anything to do with the history of BCA in Indonesia. So BCA was among the first to introduce internet banking in Indonesia, and then it was abused by some customers long time ago, like 20 years ago. Okay. And it was very well known cybercrime in Indonesia at the time. So perhaps that's why BCA now become very vigilant and very cautious about their internet banking process. Even transfer money to other banks become a laborious and painful process in BCA because you have to register the account first, okay? And in that registration, you have to fill out not only the bank and also the account number of the targeted, you know, the person who you want to send money to, but also the full name, the branch name, and everything else. Okay, so it's quite laborious. And also, every time you want to register the transfer account from other banks, you need to enter the code from the token. Okay. So let's see what happened with, for example, CIMB Niaga. If I want to send money, sorry, in CIMB Niaga, also we have, they also have security features. You need to enter some security code before you can execute a transaction. But unlike BCA, in Niaga, they don't require you to have token, but they do require you to register your mobile phone number. So the security code will be generated by Niaga system every time there's a transaction and send it through text message to your registered mobile phone. Okay. And one account can only have one registered mobile phone, if I'm not mistaken. I tried to register my mobile phone for my daughter account and it was rejected. So one account, one mobile number. Anyway, if I want to transfer money, for example, I don't need to enter anything else, but two information. First, the account number, and second, the bank. Okay, so if I put the account number and select bank, say for example Mandiri or BCA or any other bank in Indonesia, Niaga internet banking will find out which account that's belong to. And if they can find the information, it will be displayed as the account number, the bank, and also the account holder name, the customer. And I just enter the amount that I want to transfer and send transfer, and then the Niaga system will generate security code, send it to my mobile phone. I only need to enter that security code into Niaga internet banking, and that's it. Okay. Not to mention, if I transfer or pay bills using Niaga, it only costs like 6,500, while in BCA it costs like 7,500 rupiah. Okay. So For BCA, even though it's similar process to Niaga, the process is much more laborious. It require extra steps. It require extra security features compared to other banks. Okay. Even though the substance of the process is similar, everywhere in Indonesia, transfer money from one bank to another, it has similar process. It just with BCA they added another security layers that, you know, is inconvenient, but that's the way they did. So that's why every information system will require different processes. Okay. Still on the analysis part. Okay. So process model. Process model is graphically represent the process that capture, manipulate, store, and distribute data between the system, environment, and among system components. So the modeling will be based on the information gathered during requirements, and process and data structure need to be modeled. You already noticed, and you already familiar with the process modeling diagram, flow diagram. I will not repeat the topics on data flow diagram. I'd rather go through the next. Just to remind you, there are two different notation of data flow diagram. One is Jin Sarsen, which is here, and the other is DeMarco Jordan, which is here. Okay. Only data storage and process are different, but the others, source or sync, and also data flow are similar. Review the data flow diagram later, but this is how to develop data flow diagram. Okay, starting from context and then level 2. If required, you can go to level 1 and so on and so forth. Okay. And data flow diagram needs to be balanced. It means information get into the system on the upper level context, for example, should be also drawn in the lower level, level 0, for example. Some rules to or guidelines to draw data flow diagram. You are already familiar with it, so I don't. So, to use data flow diagram as analysis tools. This is simple, and I've been doing this with my students who wrote their thesis on information system analysis and development. For example, you're analyzing sales system, okay? Cash sales system. This is, I think that's, this is the simplest system that can be discussed. If you analyze cash sales system, if you remember our lecture, I think it's lecture 8 in accounting information system, where we discuss the revenue cycles. Okay, in revenue cycles, there is a data flow diagram on what's constitute as, you know, ideal revenue cycles, starting especially with sales. So the sales process has an ideal data flow diagram. Look up Romney's book on that. Okay. So that's the ideal. That's the best, if you can. One of the best process for sales, if you may. So what you need to do in order to analyze the system, the old system that you handle, you need to draw the data flow diagram of the old system, the current system that you want to change, the system that owned by your client. Okay. gather all information, interview people, make observation, read documentation, and then you create the data flow diagram for it. And then compare it to the ideal. Is there any missing process? Is there any missing data? Is there any missing people from that process compared to the ideal one? If there's any missing links or any missing process, for example, there is no authorization for credit, okay? You need to see whether that difference will have any negative impact toward the system. Okay. If you listen carefully, at the beginning I said, cash sales system, but then I mentioned about something about the missing credit authorization. Is there any impact on the cash sales system if you don't have credit authorization process? No, it doesn't, because cash sales doesn't require credit. So if the ideal data flow diagram has credit authorization, you don't need that. So that's fine. Cash sales system doesn't require credit authorization. So if it's missing, that's fine. Okay. But you can also look at who write down the, or who process the transaction. Is it different people from the one who receive the cash? In some small business, it does. In some small business, people who write down or process the transaction are the same people who receive cash. While in the ideal data flow diagram, there should be a separation between the one who created sales order and the one who received the money or payment. Okay. So let's analyze this. Obviously, separation of accounting function or duties were made for a reason, to prevent mistake, either it's deliberate error or accidental error. Whether it's intentional or unintentional error. So, if the people who process transaction also receive cash in a business, is that always a bad thing? Not necessarily. What if the person who process transaction and receive the cash is also the owner of the business? That will eliminate intentional error. Nobody steal the cash or make manipulation. That's because that's the owner. Okay. If he take out the cash for his or her own needs, that's fine. It's his or her own money to begin with. Okay. So that's fine. However, although that's eliminate intentional error, it does not eliminate unintentional error. The owner might not be intend to steal money, but he or she still could make unintentional mistake, miscalculation, mishandling the cash, put it on one lock. Cover and then forget where's the key, or forget that he or she put cash in it. When my mother was still alive, she earned a living after her. She was public servant, but after her retirement, she was selling batik in Periharjo. She had this quirky. Well, she was a little bit undisciplined with money. So often when she didn't feel it, she will store away the money she received from customer somewhere in her kiosk. Okay. So one day when she renovated her kiosk, you know, rearranged everything, she found a stack of old money tucked somewhere between all the batiks, the old batiks that haven't been sold. And it was so old that it was the money, the currency, the bank notes has been withdrawn by Bank Indonesia. Okay, so it's not a legal tender money. You know, it doesn't really you cannot pay with that money because it's so old. I think it was issued when I was in junior high school. Okay, so that long ago. So that happened. Okay. The owner of the business might not have the intention to steal money because it's his or her own money, but the owner could still make a mistake by, you know, miscalculation, misrecord, missing the record, missing the invoice, missing the money, things like that. Yeah. So that's how you analyze. You compare the old system with the ideal system. And if any differences happen or exist, you need to look at what's the impact of that toward the system. Okay. Okay, so I'll skip this decision table. So decision table usually used to represent the logic of a decision, which specifies the possible condition for decision and the resulting action. This is for complicated decision logic, for example here. This is to decide, you know, whether or not a company will pay for overtime when the employee will be considered as overtime, for example. So this is, for example, employee type S working for less than 40 hours a week. So what action need to be done? Just pay the base salary. Okay. What happen if, say for example, this age means hourly, is employee working more than 40 hours. We need to calculate the overtime. Okay. And so on and so forth. So, for example, this what need to be done by the cashier if, for example, in a supermarket, what need to be done by cashier if, for example, the cashier scan a product and then the customer said, well, that product should be discounted because I took it from a cabinet and that in that cabinet said that it has 10% discount. But when the cashier scan the product, there is no discount whatsoever. So what need to be done in that situation? Okay. That kind of scenario need to be explored. Okay. If you look at the process, you need to be aware of what kind of mistake or what kind of irregularities that can happen. Okay. Another example, when you enroll into a class, the class registration system at the beginning of the semester, I believe most of you, even my adik, all of you never had problem with payment, for example. So before you enroll in a class with class registration system, you need to pay for the fixed tuition fee, right? Okay. So after you pay for your fixed, you have your registration for that semester, your name will appear on the schedule for class registration, right? Okay. But you might also be aware that some students could not make the payment on time for various reasons. There are some people who, some student that who had difficulties, financial difficulties, and they could not get sufficient fund to pay for this fixed tuition fee on time. That's a problem. Some students just simply forget that they need to pay. Again, that's another problem. So, but the essence of that problem is they didn't pay the fixed tuition fee on time, and they were late. So what happened? What need to be done? Okay. They need to pay that. That's the first thing. Okay. But after they paid with the fine, obviously, or any other financial condition, then they need to be activated, because at the beginning of any semester, if you did not pay for your fixed tuition fee, you will be considered by the system as inactive students. But when you pay that, you will be active students. And only active students could enroll in a class with class registration system, KRS. So what happened if you make the payment late? After you complete all the payment and pay the fine, you need to be activated. And there is some sort of procedure to that. So that's the decision that was formed. Okay. So this happened every semester. I often, when at the beginning of the semester, some student will ask me, "Pak, I could not find my name on the list of enrollment schedules." Okay. So I asked the student, "Have you paid your fixed tuition fee, or have you finished the registration process?" Most of the time, the answer is no. So that's easy. Just pay the fixed tuition fee and pay the fine, and then report to the administrative office for you to be reinstated as active student. But if the student already paid the fix, I ask them to prepare the evidence, proof of payment, and then report to administration office. That's the decision logic. Okay. This is not a... Okay. Data flow diagram has been around for more than 50 years. It's older than me. Okay, and I'm quite old, at least compared to you. And it has been abandoned, actually. It's not abandoned completely, but a lot of people have moved on to another diagram. If you remember, data flow diagram doesn't really tell you the sequence of the process. Which one is first? Process number one, process number two, or process number three? Nothing in data flow diagram indicated. The number in the process is just for identification purposes. It doesn't really show any chronological order, unlike flowchart, for example, that show you chronological order. That's the first. Okay, so that's, and second, data flow diagram also lack of ability to cover exceptional condition. It means, like, if you had error, like for examples, students can register after they paid fixed tuition fee. In data flow diagram, there is nothing about what if the student haven't paid the fixed tuition fees. It's very difficult to draw those kind of condition, error or exceptional, with data flow diagram. Data flow diagram always assume that everything went smoothly, but you know for a fact that in real world, there's nothing work smoothly. There's always somebody will make mistake. There's always some chance that even the best user will make mistake. Okay, whether it's intentional or not. So then there is a object-oriented analysis in the science. This is a new technique. Well, it's not completely new, but it is a newer technique compared to data flow diagram. They try to overcome the data flow diagram weaknesses. So the first thing that used to show or to model the process is use case. Okay. Use case is a depiction of system behavior or functionality under various conditions. So the keyword here is various conditions. So with use case, you can show what happened if there is an error, what happened if there is a user that doesn't follow the procedures, things like that. Okay. So that's use case. And in use case, there is an actor. Actor is external entity that interact with the system. It could be person or any other application, but it's interact with the system. It just is like external entity in data flow diagram or the box. So this is a sample of use case. And it happened to be class registration system. Okay, similar to what I already told you. Okay, so this is student. Student register for a class. Okay. And then this is the registration clerk, and this is the instructor, the lecturer. Okay. Student register for special class. Okay. Identify prerequisite course not completed. That's for example. So when you look at the data flow diagram for class registration, you might not see the process where the system check for prerequisite. For example, if you want to take intermediate accounting 2, you have to pass intermediate accounting 1. Okay. That's a prerequisite. And there is a bursar office. This is the university. This is the faculty level that bill the student. Okay. Okay. Most actors represent user roles, but actors can also be external system. An actor is a role, not specific user. Okay. So for example, if I enroll in undergraduate degree in management, then even though I'm lecturer at accounting, I need to act as student. Okay. One user may play many roles and an actor may represent many users. Okay. A use case model consists of actor and use cases. Use cases diagram is a picture showing system behavior along with the key actors that interact with the system. Abstract use case is when use case is initiated by another use case. Use case represent completely functionality. Okay, so this is the definition and symbol. So the ellipse is the use case. The matchstick figure is the actor. Okay, so if you can't really draw a person like I do, doesn't matter because we only use matchstick figures. Boundary, the box, the boundary of the system. Connection, include connection and extend relationship. Sorry, include relationship and extend relationship. Okay. Okay, this is the definition. Actor is a role, not individual. You don't need to use case for your work. Okay, but if you want to use it, fine by me. Okay, but I don't really require you to draw use case. This is just for your knowledge. So next time you meet with a system developer and they show you use case, you know what it is. Okay. Actor is a role, not individual. Okay, involved with the functioning of the system at some basic level, represented by stick figure. Use case represent single system function, represented as ellipse. System boundary includes all the relevant use case. A boundary is the dividing line between the system and its environment. use case A within the boundary, efforts are outside of the boundary. Okay, so that's it's similar to context diagram in that way. Okay. Connection is association between actor and use case. This is to depict a usage relationship. So an actor use function of a use case. Connection does not indicate data flow. Okay. Data flow may go from user to system or from system to the data may flow from actor to use case or from use case to actor. Okay. Actors are connected to use case with lines. Use case are connected to each other with arrow. Arrow means the first use case is the functionality that will be used first by the user, the actor, and then will follow with other use case. Extend relationship is association between two use cases where one adds new behavior or action to the others. Okay. Assumption association between two use cases where one use case use the functional content in the other. So, for example, this. Okay. Manager reorder supply. So this is the first. Okay. It will include track and sales inventory data before goes to supplier. Why? Because when you buy something, if you remember the expenditure cycle, you will see whether a supplier has a good track record or not before you ordering something. If they have good track record, that's fine. Okay. And if the supplier continue to have bad track record, then maybe the company need to sever the ties, stop having business with that supplier because bad track record. Okay. Written use case is document containing detailed specification for use case. Content can be written as simple text or in specified format. Okay. This is a step-by-step description of what must occur in successful use case. So this use case, for example, this is the this is the success scenario, and there will be another that show what happened if it's failed. Okay. Level of use case refer to degree of the detailing use case description. White is the context diagram, if you will. Okay. Black or bottom of the C is the most detailed use case. Okay. This is the sample format of written use case. There are many other formats, but this is the common format. First, title, description of the use case, who is the primary actor, who is the stakeholder, what's the precondition, a condition that must be satisfied in order to execute the use case. For example, class registration system has a precondition, student is active, which is the actor, which is done by paying the fixed tuition fee. Minimal guarantee, outputs that can be expected if the service attempt fail. Success guarantee, outputs that can be expected if the service succeed. If you fail in the cost registration system, there will be notification. If you succeed, you will receive SPBK. An event or action that initiate the use case, your cost registration system, main success scenario, extension. So this is how to use use case. Okay. Primary actor use case is the title, buying a PVF standard product at web store. Primary actor is customer. Level guide is the summary or context diagram. The stakeholder is customer and shipping clerk. Precondition, customer access to web store or website. So if you want to buy something from a website, you need to access that website first. Minimal guarantee, rollback of any incomplete transaction. So if you already put the product into your shopping cart and you want to pay but the payment fail, then it will be a rollover or rollback to the previous condition. Okay. Success guarantee, order failed. If you pay that order, order will be delivered to you. Just remember what happened if you failed in any process during transaction in marketplace like Tokopedia, Bukalapak, or Shopee. trigger customer access web store homepage. So unless you access, unless the customer access the homepage, there will be no process. They will, the system will wait until the customer initiate the process. Main success scenario, customer browse catalog, customer place order for desired product, shipping clerk fill orders, customer check status order. So that's the extension and so on and so forth. Other use case, this is the more detail level, okay, and so on. Okay, that's use case. Like I said, this is just for your knowledge. Next, object-oriented analysis and design using activity diagrams. So we have use case, we have activity diagrams. So activity diagram is show the conditional logic for the sequence of system activities needed to accomplish a business process. So this is to show a business process. Clearly show parallel and alternative behavior and can be used to show the logic of a use case. So this is complementary to use case. It has to be used with a use case. Unlike data flow diagram and flowchart that can be used separately, this is not. Okay. So this is for examples. Each of these box is a use case. Okay. So element of activity, transition, branch, I will not go into detail because it's just synchronization, swim lanes, so on and so forth. And there is a sequence diagram. This is the interaction among object during certain period of time. Object is the use case. You do this. So that's the UML diagram for the system. Okay. And that's what being used currently in many places, okay, to replace data flow diagram and flow chart. To show the process. Okay. But again, there is no requirement for you to use any of this. Okay. Use case and data flow diagram, later entity relationship diagram, is used based on compromise, based on agreement. If your client agree to use activity diagram, use case, transition diagram, by all means use it. But if your client doesn't understand it, they look lost when you show them the diagram. Don't. Diagram is a communication tool. The purpose of any communication tools is to convey information and message from you to the other parties. In order for that to happen, you and the other parties have to agree on common language, common symbol. So if your client or other parties, perhaps other developers or programmers, understand use case activity diagram, then use it. If they don't, you probably have go to data flow diagram. If they don't understand that, don't agree on using that, then maybe you have to use another diagram that can be understood by the other parties. Otherwise, the purpose of diagram as a communication tool will fail. Okay, so okay, let me show you example. Again, remember that my so this is for examples. Let me. This is examples of the presentation done by the developer of PNPM MIS redesign developer presented to layman audience, to audience who doesn't really or don't really understand jargons or diagram of system development. Okay. This is to show the process. Have you seen any standard diagram in here? Is it flowchart? I don't think so. Is it data flow diagram? No, it is not. Is it activity diagram? Use case? No. Okay. This is just a circle and circles and circles and also box and arrows. Is it bad? From technical standard, perhaps, but for a communication point of view, this one is succeed. The audience understand what the developer trying to say. Okay. So, for example, this is the planning stage. This is planning stage. What are the component of planning? Optimization, normal, generation, RLF, and then this is RAP. This is the execution. This is the monitoring stage, and this is the evaluation stage. Okay. Will go as a circle like this. So if you know that this will be understood by your clients, use it. If nobody understand it, you need to change. Okay. Another example. This is a flowchart, if you like, you see. Okay? Process, 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 decision, process. Okay. Another, this is again a flowchart. Yeah, with database application, things like that. This is another, this is the architecture of the MIS3 design, which is boxes. The main point of this is to convey message to the client or any stakeholder of the system. If they can understand it, fine. If they don't, you need to find. That's why usually in a big system development group, they will hire specific person to create presentation, to create writing, to create report. This specific person need to understand who the reader of that report, who the audience of that presentation, so they can adjust all the technical term into something that can be understood by the audience or the reader. Okay. When I was invited by OSAID to Peter Quality Assurance, the first thing that I need to address was the disagreement, to put it mildly, between the developer. So the developer, they are a company, right? And they present that in front of World Bank team. World Bank, they had their own IT people. Okay. So what happened was, the World Bank IT people was appointed by World Bank to attend the discussion, and the problem that, and that's laid the problem at one meeting. The IT people from World Bank and the developers, they arguing almost an hour, okay, and could not reach agreement. I was so confused at that time too, because I arrived late into the process and I didn't understand the history of their disagreement. They were like almost fighting, you know, heated discussion, you know, doesn't accept the other party's explanation. You know. So I decided and I asked the leader, let's just end this discussion and continue other times. Okay. So after I review the meeting minutes, I review all the documentation. You know what happened? Both parties actually agree on something. they actually saying the same thing. It just in different language. Not, you know, like when you say that I like ice cream on in with English and the other person using Javanese language that translated I like ice cream. Both parties insisted that they like ice cream, but in different language, and nobody understand each other language. Can you imagine that? So that's what happened. Why? The developer has been around for long time. Okay. They have come to the conclusion that, like what I mentioned to you earlier, diagram is a communication tools. So you need to create something that can be understood. The problem with IT people from the World Bank, most of them are very young. Most of them only had 2 or 3 years working experience. They are fresh graduate from well-known universities in Indonesia. And they still stick to the books that they read during the their university years. And in that book, they said, it said, you have to use this, this, and this. While the developers, because they already have working experience longer than the, they use different terms. But it's actually the same thing. They argue on the same thing they actually agreed on, but with different language. That's why I told you earlier, diagram is just communication tools. That's just it. Okay. So used to it. The problem with the developer was they don't understand that IT people from World Bank, they were fresh, mostly very young, only have less than 5 years experience, and still stick to the textbook that they read while in university. So if the developers change the diagram to the one similar to the textbooks, the problem would be over. And I told this to my boss, the AUSAID person, the AUSAID official. And then I approached the developer and told them, so this is what the World Bank means. They understand. And then I met with the World Bank IT people, and I said, look, the developer used this because this is what they usually do. So, but that means this, similar to what you arguing. So actually both people believe in the same thing, but in different language. So that's reality, okay? Okay, any question about the diagram today? For your work later, you can use data flow diagram or flowchart or use case if you feel it. But I don't require you to use any complicated. If you like to use case, fine. Use data flow diagram, not a problem. Using flowchart, I can read it. Any question? There's no questions. I think that's it for today. Like I said, I'll send I'll write down the progress report specification and deliver it to you. And then I'll set up the midterm exam submission when I receive the schedule. I haven't received the schedule yet. It's probably after the Easter break. Okay. Because we still had a lecture after the Easter break. What else? So you prepare your progress report, okay? And have a great and safe Easter break, and see you after this. Okay, bye.
Thank you, sir.